Good news, everyone. Welcome to the 12th episode of The OC Show. We are in the season 3. This is October, and there's a lot of things that did happen in the past few weeks. Actually, the past few weeks since we were back online. And we are tonight being joined with a special guest, Carl from Mr. Tech QC. How are you doing?
Very good. Yourself?
Ah, always good, always good. So we're going to talk a little bit more about you and what you do on our mainly on our YouTube channel, actually. And of course, we have Timothée Tchiala from OCTV, master of the camera and the production in this live show. How are you doing, man?
Yeah, very good, thanks. So if something gets broken, it's my fault. Thanks for telling everyone.
At least for once, that's not going to be mine or Massman's fault. So yeah, I think we are all happy for that. Thank you guys for tuning in. It's been a while. We haven't been online, but we have been... You know, going around for a lot of things. We went to the HWBOT World Tour in Indonesia. Then actually I went to the TwitchCon as well, that we might be talking a little bit more in this show. Let's talk about you, Carl. I mean, the reason why you are here with us tonight is because you have been doing some interesting video on YouTube, but I don't want to spoil all the fun. That's your first time on the show. So can you just introduce yourself to all the viewers?
Well, basically, I make tech reviews in French. I am one of few persons to do them in French in North America. So my video is in French, but I'm kind of bilingual. So if you have some questions, I can still answer. Soon you can see me on the Best Buy blog, where I'll do reviews and general articles about tech. And just teasing, I might review a test bench soon. Not saying what kind.
You mean what kind of test bench? Like an open thing, like open case something
with the something with like that. Something like that.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So yeah, you're based actually. You're based in Montreal. I mean, not Montreal, but Montreal area. So
area exactly.
So yeah, actually, that's the reason why you might get one of the test bench, because I did receive mine just a few days ago. Maybe I can just show it, because I'm very happy that
so
I got
done
it.
With it.
Yeah.
Like the whole show before when we were preparing.
Yeah, I got mine. Yeah.
Oh my god.
So to prove it's not a fake and just not just a box. Yeah. Okay, I have to admit, this is the one of the three that I have, because I bought them, and oh my god, that's so cool.
I think we need to mention, Truth, that you were so excited that you dropped your laptop on it.
Yeah, oops.
That only
but
happens to
honestly,
me.
Honestly, I can't wait to actually build them. I might actually build them on the channel, on the OverClocking-TV, so if you want to see it, just, just subscribe or actually follow us. And if you're watching this on YouTube, just go to the twitch.tv overclocking TV channel, so you can subscribe and know when we are going live to test just a few things. Actually, I was thinking a little bit more about what we can do here, but that's not the topic for tonight. Let's go back to Carl. So what are you doing the topic for tonight? Yeah.
No, go ahead. I thought you were about to mention
Carl,
all the topics.
Carl is one of the topic, of course. But the other topics for tonight are, now you can push the slide. Yeah! Oh yeah! Editors pick, so the kind of news that we like or not this week, the latest OC esports competition update. What did happen in the last few days? And obviously, there was one big last remaining competition for this year to get to the HWBOT World Championship Final, so the Overclocking World Championship Final. That was the HWS Wildcard Qualifier, and we have a lot more to discuss about that. I'm going to talk a little bit about the 1050 and the 1050 Ti, the upcoming new VGA from Nvidia. And you know, there's nothing announced yet, but we have some information and links that happen. And we're gonna have a quick review of the TwitchCon 2016, because I went there, I think that was like 3 weeks ago, and that was quite interesting to see all the Twitch phenomena and the people around that.
You're
so let's go back to you, Carl, for a little eh?
Lucky guy. I wish
yeah,
I
that was
seemed like a,
that was nice. That like I will have the time to talk about that, but to me that was one of the best conventions I ever attended, and yeah, you will know why after. All right, let's go back to you, Carl, before we switch to the next topic. How did you all started your YouTube channel?
Well, basically, I have a father working in IT programming for a TV channel here in Montreal. And basically, over time, I just play with computers and everything. And I learned everything through internet, YouTube. Right now, I'm a student with in Cisco in networking and servers. But before that, I saw Lunch Tech tips like everyone did. I saw Unbox Therapy when he did more like tech stuff and KBHD, all those tech YouTubers. And I guess I got my inspiration from there. I've evolved, grew up a bit in terms of quality. And I mean, as everyone, I play with the electronics that was laying in my basement. And from there, I got a passion from it.
Sounds familiar for some reason.
It's about the same for everyone.
It seems like everyone started the same way. Like, oh yeah that was fun.
And then it was in the basement too, like with some old PCs and things. That's cool. Yep.
We all killed a couple CPUs before being able to build a true computer.
Yes.
So, what are the main topic that you were actually discussing in your videos for the people that don't know you yet?
So during the live, I will be discussing two main topics. The first and foremost, Qualcomm, you know, the company that makes these Snapdragon CPUs for smartphones, came out with a new modem for your smartphones, which is the X50, which will be capable of 5G. And after that, I'll talk about the Google Pixel, the new phone by Google.
Yeah.
So I'll start
with jump you know what? Let's jump to it. I mean, the Qualcomm X50 5G. So what's so special about that one?
Well, even if 4G is pretty quick, it's quick depending on where you are. But Qualcomm pushed it to a whole nother level. Right now, 4G is about 330 megabits per second, which is not bad. I mean, pretty quick. That's theoretical. But now they pushed it to 5 gigabits, and we're moving to the we're actually moving on 28 gigahertz. So that's a pretty high frequency. Right now there's a couple problems in terms of signal strengths and pushing the signal through walls. But right now it's just prototype. There's no phones or any antennas that actually have the technology. It's brand new. It's going to be on the market for 2017, so a few phones can get it and implement it. And later on, about in 2018, South Korea and Japan have some plans into implementing these antennas, like in the street. And France is planning for 2020.
They're still far away.
That's still not that close. But the biggest issue would be like, I mean, the node itself gonna have to have the bandwidth for that many people using that kind of bandwidth as well.
Exactly. Yeah. And even then, it's not everywhere still in Canada or France or anywhere where it's not the whole country that's on 4G yet. So it's gonna take some time before everyone gets on it.
So we have cell phone coverage, then we have a lower one that is 3G coverage, and then we have a lower one that is 4G coverage, and I'm gonna have the very, very, very small one that is 5G coverage.
Yeah,
well, so basically, it's like outside
when you transition, yeah? Always like that.
Yeah, yeah. But even though it's crazy, because even today at 4G speed, let's say we don't overclock our modem, stuff like this, but at 4G speed, there's some locations that are faster by waves than actually the landlines. Actually, that's the case for Dr. Wiz. That's actually why he's using the 4G for streaming. So actually, guys, if you don't know about Dr. Wiz, he's streaming usually at least once a week. Usually twice, and it's on a Twitch TV / Dr. Wiz, DRWEEZ, I think.
Yeah, underscore.
I think that's it. Yeah. And that guy is actually streaming to Twitch over his 4G connection.
Yeah, since you mentioned waves being faster, it's the same for high-speed trading. They also use radio waves and UHF to transmit data from towers to towers. It's faster than using fiber.
Yeah.
And it's cheaper because you just need towers and you don't need to do roadblocks.
Yeah, there's no physical connection. So.
Yeah, it's a lot cheaper. And I mean, the way to interrupt a wireless signal is a little bit more difficult than cutting just a network cable, you know. So
sure thing.
It could pass anywhere potentially. All right. That's a cool news. Well, maybe one day I will have 5G. I still have 3G on my phone, guys.
Yeah, actually, that's great. And you live in Taiwan, so you could have 4G right now. Like, yeah, but pretty much all
you know,
the islands.
You know, that's the thing with Taiwan. There's Wi-Fi everywhere. So technically speaking, unless you actually, for some reason, don't want to have fiber at home, which I have, so I don't actually need to have fast internet on my phone. I walk down to the metro. I have Wi-Fi in the metro. I arrive at the office, there's Wi-Fi at the office. And actually, I can still get my Wi-Fi signal from the office half the way to the metro station almost, because the router is so powerful. So it's like, okay, all good.
Well, I mean, one issue I see with 5G is that in Europe and Asia, cost in terms of internet data on your mobile, it's not that bad. But in America, I don't want even to imagine the cost of 5G. Maybe even like a 2 gigabytes a month. The fees are going to be insane in the first few months.
For sure, it would be ridiculous. It would be ridiculous, for sure.
Oh my god, that's crazy. So next topic I wanted to talk was another thing related to smartphones, the Google Pixel and Pixel XL.
Exactly. Well,
I want the XL. I want one.
Really? Yes.
Really badly. Well, I want one. But
it does look
expensive.
Very nice. But yeah, it's expensive.
I think everyone at the conference was like kind of skeptical, like is it nice, is it not? No one really liked the design, but over time it kind of grew over me. I was finally, the separation on the back of the phone, I like it. And for the people that are not aware of the specs, we're running a Snapdragon 821 and 4 gigs of RAM. And in practice, it's apparently faster than the Samsung Galaxy S7. So we're looking at a very high-end phone here. And it's the first phone on the market to truly integrate, at the moment you buy the phone, Android 7 Nougat. So you get a whole lot of new features. Especially on this version, you get the long press, which is kind of the competition to 3D Force Touch on the iPhone. Which on your home screen, when you press long press, you get some options. There's a few unboxing and first looks on YouTube from MKBG, and a few others. But I think it's a really nice phone. We'll see over time how price manages out in Canada, because we have a lower dollar value.
It's over $1,000 Canadian if you want.
I know.
It better go down. Actually, that's the only reason why I didn't bought it yet. Because honestly, like $300 difference, I can buy a new laptop.
Yeah.
It's like, whoop!
Actually, question, the thing at the back, the round thing, is that just like a button, power button or something? Like the round
it's
thing?
A fingerprint, I believe.
Oh, I see. I
might be mistaken on this one, but I'm pretty sure it is.
Yeah. I was reading yesterday a review on, I think it's a guy, I'm not sure which website, I think maybe it was on Medium, like a blog post. And the guy bought the phone and he said he was not really impressed with the assistant stuff, which Google talked a lot about.
Yes, Google Assistant.
And he said it's just a glorified version of Google Now, which everyone has anyway. And
exactly.
That is not great at all. Google Now totally sucks. You can tell him anything you want, it will not get it. Like, really, unless you give the commands exactly right, it doesn't interpret anything. So
it's just because of your accent.
No, really, it gets everything right. It just makes a Google search with it, and I don't care, you know, if I tell him, I don't know, for example, add a call tomorrow in my schedule with this guy at 5 p.m., then it just makes a Google search with that, and it's like, thanks for telling Google search about what I'm trying to schedule for tomorrow. It doesn't always work.
Reminder.
You need to get it every... Reminder, yes, but that's not a Google calendar. That doesn't add a
calendar. Adding something in the calendar is more complex.
Well, any kind of assistant is good with any dictionary word, but once you get into abbreviations, some usernames from the internet, they just go crazy. I think Apple still has the edge with Siri, because most of the time it's responsive and gets what you want to get done. But Google Now, in my opinion right now, has a little bit of work to do. When you just ask a search, like, search this, search that, it works. But as Timothée said, when you go into deeper actions, it doesn't do what you want. Sometimes just plain mistake, or does a whole other thing. So
Do
you want to call John?
Yeah, like the guy in the article was saying, like, for example, you go out, right, and you're at a location, and you say, hey, what other bars are around here, you know? And I mean, like, that would
be. You can drive 200 kilometers away and you're going to find the best
bar in town. It's going to Google Drive what other bars are around here. Like a Google search. You know? So he said, like, yeah, he was a bit disappointed for that. Otherwise, he seemed to be impressed with the phone. It's very iPhone style design, I suppose.
Yeah.
I mean, like, well, actually, besides the back, right? But if you look at it.
Yeah, but the back is this, it's a mix between like the iPhone in the bottom and something else different in the top. And actually, my flatmate was like quite vocally. Not aggressive, but quite vocal about the fact that they copied the iPhone and didn't even copy it right. I like it. I don't mind this design. But
all the phones nowadays look a bit the same anyway. I mean,
they look all the same. Like the Samsungs and the iPhones, they copy each other for years. So
yeah.
I mean, let's be fair. It's the first phone that Google makes that's not co-engineered with another brand. So it's actually quite impressive. Yeah.
The real discussion should be actually there. Why are they not working with the regular vendors anymore? Right?
Because they maybe they maybe don't want to give IDs and
I think it's somehow get them right.
It's that
or update cycle, right? Like maybe they were not satisfied with the software updates. I mean, I had the Nexus 7, like the tablets. I had the Nexus 4, so that one was from LG. The tablet was from Asus, and yeah, sure, you had updates, but after one generation of Android, it was pretty much over. You had to wait like 6 months to get the update, and it was slow. It was really bad. It was not like nothing really special, nothing you would expect from buying a Nexus device. You know?
Yeah.
So I guess
either that, or they wanted hands on the design and really make this is Google and this is what the phone we want looks like. Because when you co-engineer something with another brand, they have something to say about it. Oh, we would prefer to give this
direction.
Way. Exactly.
They might make more money this way also, I suppose.
Also.
I mean, like, everyone has to make money at some point, and if they spend so much money already on Android, maybe, I don't know how much they're getting back, but are they getting enough back for all the efforts they put in it? I don't know, right?
Actually, they almost try any big vendors. They made one with LG, they made one with Samsung, they made one with Asus. That they made one with Huawei in China, so it's pretty much like, okay guys, you all had your chance, so now you know how to do it. Okay, so now we go do it right and you can follow now.
It's a little bit like this. I think it's still it boils down also to the problem of Android being it seems to be more complicated than we think to adapt the OS to a device to make it work really well. And because there's so many phones getting released every year, most of the companies that manufacture those phones, they just don't have the manpower to deal with it. Like even for Samsung, it's hard to recall 2 million phones. So why do you want to try to update the last 200 phones you launched in the last 2 years, right? Like, really, how is that even possible? So yeah, I guess that's part of the big problem. We'll see if Google does a better job at that, actually, because now they actually have to deliver, right? Because people will be expecting them, and especially if they charge more for the phone.
Yeah. Actually, they don't charge more than the previous one, than the 6P.
Yeah,
actually, the top and run, it's $40 less.
I bought my Nexus 4 for like 400 US.
I'm just comparing with the 6P, the latest one from Huawei.
Well, at this point in the cell phone market, any phone that does not explode is a good phone.
I might have a 3310 in my drawer. Maybe the value picked up.
Be careful, guys.
Yeah, let's not be taken down by Samsung. Let's move to the next topic.
Okay. Talking about Samsung, the Samsung 960 Pro M.2 SSD is on the market, and they have the storage up to 2 terabytes on an M.2 card size. It's crazy.
That's
2 terabytes.
Really amazing.
So
that's
this
cool.
is it. We don't have the storage limitation anymore. We don't have the limitation of the speed, because the speed is quite insane as well. So that's it. We are basically almost topping up on this market as well. So the bottleneck was the hard drive for a while, then the SSD came in, then the SSD became the bottleneck again, and then we had new NANDs, new formats, etc. And then now we have the M2 that is up to 2 terabytes. Actually, I can't wait to have a new laptop and have this inside, and then that's it.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. Thanks for your support.
Yeah, well, if you want to get a 1 terabyte one, it's still $1,299 for the best one, right? For the
Not that cheap. Ridiculously expensive, but we all know that over time this will just go down. Yeah, actually, a 2 terabyte SSD, even in regular form, is quite expensive as well. Half that price. But
it's more than half the price.
About like $680 USD for like a 1 terabyte SSD, and you know, with the new kind of NAND that's gonna arrive on the market.
Yeah, but you don't get nowhere near that speed.
That speed is PCI Express speed. No. That's completely crazy. Like 3,500 megabytes per second for read and like 2,100 for write. But basically, it's like, okay, we are here now. So that stuff exists on the market. It's accessible, I would say, for professionals or someone that, let's say, you do like a lot of video editing. But these kind of SSDs will be more used for people doing virtual machines, etc. But well, that's something affordable for this kind of usage. Of course, if you're just having a laptop for watching movies, that's not the market, you're aiming at, right?
Well, I mean, you're not really paying.
Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead. Okay. Well, you're not only paying $1,300 for the 2 terabyte, you're also paying for like insane speeds, and for random read, we're looking at 450,000 IOPS, which is an insane amount of IOPS compared to just their 950 Pro at 270K, which is a very good leap in terms of performance. So
yeah,
the price, in my opinion, for the generation, even
these ones, they have the Pro in the name. That's not for anything, right? That's definitely for professional. And the IOPS, as I say, like for the virtual machines, like the swap for some virtual machines and so on, that's actually super important as well.
True, very true. Yeah.
All right. Tim, what's your news of the week?
So, you know, I like all the space stuff. So I watched, I think it was last week or something, but I didn't watch it live, but it was the Elon Musk from SpaceX and Tesla, etc., ex-PayPal. So this guy, if you don't know him, he's a kind of a crazy guy that say stuff that no one would dare to say. In a good way. Every historical generation, right? You have this one person that sort of stands out and that dares to say, but also do what he says, that stuff that people would probably never want to, you know, say. And so he's the one going out there and saying, pretty much, what the fuck? Why are we not on Mars yet? And so basically, I think he's a kind of a bit of a weird guy, you know, in the way he speaks, but he has a brilliant mind. And there's a whole video about it and where he explains his plan, but basically it's called the SpaceX Interplanetary Transport System. And it's crazy idea of basically, you know, he already has the reusable rockets that can land themselves and things like that. But what he wants to do now is actually make one that is so massive that you could actually send like 100 to 200 people at once to Mars. You have to imagine, right? Because now it's complicated to get 10 astronauts to the space station, right? And keep them alive for 1 year.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
It's crazy. He's saying like he wants to do a rocket that is like 180 meters high. I think that was about 220. And it's like, you need to send at least 100 people every 2 years. Otherwise, it's not worth it.
Yeah, like, it's not worth it. And he says on top of that, like, it takes several rockets from Earth to go fill that kind of mothership that will be stationed in space because it's so big, right? And then basically ship the more fuel to that rocket several times to fill it up so he can actually like drive it all the way to Mars.
If you stop, it's dead.
Yeah. I mean, like, it's a crazy plan, really. And if it goes through, it will be quite crazy for, I guess, humanity or something. But yeah, so that was my my news of the week. When I watched this, I was like, holy shit, he's going to do it.
Maybe one day. Yeah, maybe one day overclocking with no gravity will be a thing.
Actually, we can think about Edelman's like overclocking rockets right now. That's pretty much like it.
Well, yeah, besides the fact that this rocket looks like a giant dildo, it's a gigantic idea.
Well, actually, even the I think that Space Blue, the company from Jeff Bezos from Amazon, it's kind of like this. It always looked like quite a phallic form per se. Thank you, Tim. Moving on to the last one and talking about Amazon, they might actually, there's some rumors that they might consider doing their own internet services to bundle with their Prime, the Amazon Prime,
ISP,
actually the Twitch Prime, their own ISP basically.
Okay.
That could make sense. The cost of bandwidth for them is actually quite impressive if you consider they want to deliver a lot of things to you, and they do actually deliver a lot of things to you. When it's materials, so you get the Twitch Prime, when you buy stuff online and get delivered to you the next day or even the same day, depending where you live. And they pretty much say like, yeah, everything is going to be digital, no provided. So, well, if we own part of the network, that's going to be less expenses for us. So yeah. That's that makes sense. Actually, on these notes, like, a big data center, because, the Amazon Web Service is one of the biggest, hosting system in the world. And that would make sense for them to actually use part of that bandwidth for, consumer, like an ISP. Yeah. And actually, that's already exist in France from OVH. OVH, that's the leader in the web hosting solution in Europe. That's actually where we have most of the web server for overclocking TV. We have some at Amazon and some at OVH. And they are already offering SDSL and ADSL connection in Europe. I think that's only in France for now, but they plan to expand that in other part of France as well. And that's quite interesting. Because that's going to be some tech companies going into a world that is usually managed by cable companies. So the telecommunication system is usually owned by cable companies, and they do own part of the entertainment as well. Well, think about Netflix now. Netflix doesn't have any infrastructure. They got some issue with Comcast and so on. So there's going to be like more and more, of these things going on in the next few years. I'm pretty sure in 5 years from now we're going to have all the major, even Google is already doing it with Google Fiber. So, I think that's going to be something going on.
Are they going to implement at some point their physical network, or are they just going to use and pay the fees from what's already installed? It's going to make a big difference, I guess.
That's the big difference with Google, because they lay down their own network.
Yeah.
But it's very limited and centered around
expensive.
Some specific
city. They were not expecting it would be that expensive. Because in
that's
the US,
the you deal with government.
Going back now and saying, and oops.
And at some point, you need the need to have that much bandwidth, because when they run fiber, you have to use that much bandwidth, because for most people that just check their emails, check YouTube videos, DSL is fine. ADSL is fine for what they do. Fiber, most of us watching the stream, or even us, we're insane on it. We're going to use it 24/7. It's just that at some point, fiber is not going to be useful for everyone at 900 megabits per second.
Yeah, and I think, Amazon sells a lot of stuff, right? Like they sell now their own kind of tablets, their own phones, their own kind of Chromecast for the TVs. And I think for them, they can lower the price by just having no storage on those devices. If everything is on their server, you just have one copy somewhere pretty much. Not really one copy, because it's on multiple servers in the cloud, but it's easier for them to maintain than having to deal with more complicated device that cost more to the customers, so they are less competitive, or they have to compete against the others. And once they will have those cheapest device on the market, which don't have storage but have access to all of their library of content. I was even reading the other day that going into the music business the same way you have iTunes. So you can stream all the music from Amazon too. Then, why people would need storage at home? You just have a fiber connection to your hard drive.
And then
it's kind of a weird transition with super fast SSDs from before. But I guess you will have the two types of users, or the two type of use cases. And But the day
the
you
local
can stream
and
Blu-ray
the cloud
full
user.
Quality, it's over for home storage, I think.
True.
All right, guys, I think we really have to move on to the next topic.
Go ahead.
Yeah, because that's already half an hour. Damn, yeah. That's a...
Wow, that's...
I think we went a little bit long on that.
Yeah. Thank you guys for tuning in. I want to give a big shout-out to Joverclock. I can do it in French. Merci bien, ça fait plaisir. And yeah, thanks for the follow. And if you guys are watching this for the first time, don't forget to follow us here on Twitch.tv. Online competition update. Team, what did happen in the competition in the past few weeks?
This is a quick overview of the schedule for the year, just to give you a kind of a preview of what it's like. So basically in the last 3 weeks, there's one major one that finished, that was the World Series, the Wildcard Qualifier, so we're going to talk about that later. So that's the page. There's the Galaxy GOC 2016 Qualifier that opened just a few days ago. So this is a competition that used to be hosted in the previous years on the FutureMark website. But this year, Galax is also willing to do a bit of memory overclocking and things like that. So it's a bit of diversifying the benchmarks. And because of that, they chose, I guess, HWBOT and OC Esports to host the qualifiers. There's several stages. I guess we'll see some of the big names. You always see some of the guys that put their initial scores. Dark Venom from Brazil, Bullshooter in Germany, Dr. Weez. So the last two are actually qualified guys for the World Championship. So it gives you a glimpse at the level of the competition. There's the ROG Camp, which will be, which is a German-only competition, but it's worth to mention if there's any Germans on the stream. You can basically win sort of a weekend with Roman in Berlin in Germany, and he's going to teach you how to overclock.
Oh, such a nice weekend with Roman.
Well, yeah.
He will hate me for saying that.
He's going to teach you how to overclock with liquid nitrogen. So it's for people that already have overclocking experience, right? It's not a competition for total noobs, even though you could actually try your luck. It's probably not that bad. There will be, I believe, the top eight guys will be brought to Berlin, and they will have 1 day of training and practice, and the next day they actually have a small competition there, which will be streamed live on OCTV. So that will be in the first weekend of December. More to come on that. Other competitions going on, if you are a rookie, there's still the Rookie Rumble series for AMD, for Intel, as well as the Novice Nimble. Still as much as such a massively popular competition, 435 overclockers in that one. So you can see that guy, Seer Try a lot, he is also in the top guys from the ROG camp, if you paid some attention. So you can see that actually some rookies can rank well in some more national competitions.
Days ago, so if we look at the ranking, we had
there was some kind of crash. Actually, not everything is still is fixed, but I let you continue on that. The time I fixed is something crashed somewhere in the Windows. So let me check 2 seconds.
That's the love of doing live. So the Rookie Rumble AMD 33, that was the French guy called Potato, that won with the 141 points. And then we had some guys from Canada, some guys from Russia, some guys from Switzerland. So yeah, that was quite interesting to see the AMD rookie guy. If we look at the few other ones, I think we can actually move on to the next one. There's the Novice Nimble that is actually starting in 3 days. There's one that finished 4 days ago as well. So you start with the Rookie Rumble and then you move on to the Novice Nimbles. Of course, this one was actually won by overclock.net, the team-based competition, of course, and they actually managed a full-out run. They won the five stages. They got 50 points each stages, and they actually max out the scores. That's quite interesting to see overclock.net, you know, kicking back in there. I don't see Cocotlan, that used to be quite active, the French team, but we have Team Hardware.ifr, HFR, that is one of the actually biggest forum in France, that is picking up now at 6th place on the Novice Nimble, and we have on 4th place our overclocking, the Reddit overclocking team, that is actually quite quite interesting, and there's actually Bill Zoid, the captain of that, is actually streaming quite a lot lately, so you can go check it out on the Twitch TV, Bill Zoid, B-O-U-B-U-I-L-D. Well, I would copy that in the chat. Anyway.
And I fixed everything! Woohoo! Thanks,
yeah!
For some reason, Logitech still hasn't figured out how to do webcam drivers. It's my bad, I should not use a webcam to begin with. Anyway, thanks for the competition, Truth. There's one more thing I think that you just haven't mentioned, is that if you look at the schedule, there hasn't been any communication yet about that, but there's something called the Country Cup, which is the one also of the last very big competitions that would be coming this year. And so if you are into competitive overclocking and want to participate as a country, so with your fellow country mates, this is something that is going to come very, very soon. So keep an eye on the HWBOT front page. All the details will be unveiled in the coming weeks, I've been told. So that's going to be a very interesting competition as well, on top of everything else. So very, very busy time, actually.
Great. So let's talk about the wildcard competition.
Yes, of course.
All right, the wildcard competition. So the HWBOT World Tour. We had like 6 qualifiers around the world, like Brazil, South Africa, Taiwan, Canada, Europe, Indonesia. And actually, after Indonesia, people were like, "Yeah, well, there's one more seat available." So yeah, and that's when I found the wildcard competition, the HWBOT World Tour wildcard competition. That was the last way for the overclockers to actually access the Overclocking World Championship. That's going to be the biggest championship for this year. And of course, that was quite interesting to see. That is interesting to see as well that even though the battle was super, super intense, that was the first competition that was paid entry. So that was the first time this kind of competition happened. So there was about 10 people competing for this special stuff. And there were some interesting limitations. So of course, you can see the scores, the 297.3 and 297. That is extremely close. And actually, when the timer run off, looking up and DenCup were in a tie, like complete tie. They had both together exactly the same number of points. It's crazy. Like, come on, you can have 300 point maximum and they end up having the same exact amount of points based on the percentage of the score.
No one knew what the tiebreaker was supposed to be.
I saw the tweet. I was just like, that never happens. I was just like, wow.
Yeah.
No, it's like the point system was based on the percentage of the best score. So every time you improve your score, you actually have change in that. That would actually make sense. It's actually extremely difficult to have exactly the same, with a decimal. It's actually quite extremely difficult to have the same amount of points. But they managed to do it in a way. So I was like, what? What?
Yeah. Well, actually they had to go to the second decimal to be able to make a difference, which the ranking was not doing. So you could not see it, right?
Well, anyway, after all the scores, the competition always end up, and then you have the scores. Like every score is checked to see if everything is in place and so on. And in the end, we have actually Lukinub winning by 0.3 point against DenCup. It's crazy. I mean, what?
Unbelievable.
And unbelievable. And team, actually, that was the night for us when the last few minutes happened. So how was it in the HWBOT office to see the scores popping up and popping down?
There was a good hour and a half, 2 hours when I left the office on that day. So I just went home and I switched on the TV and just put the rankings on there while I was eating dinner. And I think Peter was at the restaurant and also put out the laptop and was looking at the scores. It was quite cool, knowing also that Lucky Noob was still benching until the last minute. So he was really trying to improve his scores to somehow, you know, try to get an extra whatever in case Dan Cup had extra backup scores. So the story is Yeah.
Dan Cup even told me he was submitting the last score from the bench PC directly.
Yeah. Like that's how tight it was. Like, and you usually never see those guys having internet on their bench systems. So like it's really tight. You don't have the time to copy to USB and go on your laptop and upload the scores. Yeah, it's the kind of competition that is it's perfect, you know. It's the kind of competition and the ending you are looking for when it's such a kind of competition where you get a qualified seed into a world championship final. So I think it was quite exciting. I hope we'll see more of that, of course, happening all the time, because hopefully maybe the Galax qualifier will be the same. I would not be surprised that in Germany it would be the same as well for the ROG camp. So you can see that reaching a certain level anyway, sure, there's always a bit of hardware lottery, you know, going on, but that's very minimal when you reach that level, because everyone spends so much time, so much efforts tweaking and tuning their cards, finding the best of everything, that everyone ends up with the best of everything. So everyone is on the same, you know, on the same base. And it just played out very well. And even Splave on the third place, congratulations to him as well. It was also tight for him. Like, if you look, he's not that far away. So yeah, overall, it was quite an impressive competition.
Like, I remember like 8 hours before the end of this competition, I made a post on OCTV, like, we have the top six within 15 points in the end. So like basically anything can change in the next 8 hours. And actually it did. There's a lot of things that that did change in that amount of time. Actually, if we look at the score, that was quite impressive to see that Lucky Noob was extremely precise in actually tuning his system. The reason is his CPU was at 5.6 gigahertz, and when he was fighting against Dan Cup, that is at 6 gigahertz, like over 6 gigahertz for the Core i3-6320. And if you look at the graphic cards, Lucky Noob was at 650 when Duncan was at 1600. But then, you know, that's 50 megahertz for the GPU. That's not that much, right? And even the memory. So that's for the Firestrike Extreme. But even the memory, like Duncan was much higher with tighter timings. So Lucky Noob actually pushed everything he could from the system to actually get the extra amount of points. That was quite impressive for that, and especially as he was not participating in any of the previous HWBOT World Tour. He did actually help out for the Indonesian one, but he did not participate. He did not compete there for the matches. So that was his last and unique chance actually of getting qualified. So that was quite fun to see. Congratulations to him. Congratulations to Dan Cobb. He's winning a 6950X CPU. Lucky Noob is getting
one
the
more
tickets
to his collection.
Yes. It's like free binning. And Lucky Noob is getting the plane tickets to go to the Overclocking World Championship. That's going to be in early December, from December 2 to 4, right after the ROG camp. And of course, all the guys like Splave was a tight battle for that. Actually, Splave, Ruff, Extreme Addict, and are quite close in terms of points. And B-Boy G's and Family the Bull were actually extremely close in terms of points as well. So that was quite interesting. There's only one guy that did not manage to submit any score in this competition, is Jixman. Jixman actually did attend some of the HWBOT World Tour event from last year and from this year. And he posted online in the forum, like, oh, okay, guys, I think he crashed his graphic cards. And it's like, okay, guys, I don't have the time to get a new one and bench for it. So, yeah, that's going to be it for me. So, yeah, that's quite an impressive, display of tweaking skills by Lucky Noob and pushing skills by Dan Cup, if I can say. That's awesome, man. I mean, that's great. That's gonna be that's gonna be fun to see all of the guys in Berlin. Last point about this and the scores: the three mark 11 scores from Dan Cup were actually the best one, and he was at 6.160 megahertz. So this gigahertz, this is extremely high for this kind of CPU. Okay, keep in mind the Core i3-6320 is not supposed to be unlocked. It's not supposed to. There is some way of doing it, but it's not supposed to, right? So these guys were actually pushing as crazy stuff on the hardware that is actually not costing that much. I like the way, I don't know for you guys, but I like the way that the requirement for the competition were not that high. You have to pay the entry.
It was on purpose.
But it's quite affordable to do. Of course, that's going to be crazy tight and crazy impressive for the hardware of the guys, but you can, it's accessible competition.
Yeah, that was
compared
that was
to
plan.
The high-end hardware, yeah.
All right. Well, thank you guys for your good input on that one. And let's move on to the GTX 1050 and 1050 Ti. Carl, what's going on with this one? It's not announced yet.
So the big news this week in the graphics card world was Nvidia announcing the GTX 1050 and 1050 Ti. So first and foremost, the prices. In USD, the 1050 is at 109 and the 1050 Ti is at 139, technically 140, but these are the exact prices. The official launch is at the 25th of October. Obviously, the custom boards are going to come out later on. It's a direct competition towards the RX 460, which is out in the area of the 100 USD for the 2GB version and the 129 USD for the 4GB version. In theory, for the bang for the buck, if we check spec for spec, compare Pascal to the RX lineup, the Nvidia side should be faster. We don't have any real numbers out yet, even less for the custom boards. In terms of specs, the 1050 has 2GB of GDDR5. Obviously, we don't expect any kind of new memory GDDR5X on the low-end graphics cards. We have 640 CUDA cores and a boost clock of 1455 on the core. The 1050 Ti is slightly higher with 4GB and 112GB of per second of bandwidth and 768 CUDA cores, the brands right now that have their custom coolers, but they're not custom boards yet, are EVGA, Gigabyte, Asus, Zotac, Galax, Eno 3D, iGame, and MSI. And that's it for the main specs. Obviously, it's going to be a 1080p, probably a 60fps card. And where does this come interesting? It's a entry-level card that could be accessible for, as we're talking about, entry-level overclocking. So in the same area of the G3258 or these i3 we're talking about, with some custom boards, with some custom modifications that overclockers will obviously do, compared to the GT710. The GT710 is a cheap card, and there's amazing competitions, even like custom blocks for it that people made. We can push very hard on small GPUs these days and for a small amount of money. So it's going to make, for sure, very nice competitions. And from what we've seen yet, the Pascal lineup is a very nice, usually very good overclocking. And the basic card is a 75W TDP. So basically, without any modifications, it runs off the PCIe. But some overclockers, I'm sure, is going to put a 6 or maybe even 8 pin on that thing and push voltage crazy.
Yeah, I'm sure some of the guys really think, like, I'm going to remove the PWM of that one again.
Yeah.
75 watts. To the extreme, for sure.
Yeah. Well, like 75 watts, let's put 600 watts to it. Like, I think that's going to be fine. The fun thing with the 710 competition from the CCTF team. That was like, I loved it. I love that competition. I mean, it's okay. This one is like a little bit more than $100, but the 710 was like $60.
35, 45, depending on the market. Even
yeah. It's like,
Like, in Taiwan here, it's so cheap, really.
Yeah, too bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's crazy. That's crazy.
Those cards are great because for extreme overclocking or even just overclocking or someone that wants to learn vault modding and maybe zombifying cards or even just basic electronics of how graphics cards work, it's the perfect card where you can experiment things on. Right? You just take off the cooler and just start to look around and maybe solder some very simple modes that you find on the internet.
That's very accessible for newcomers.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't find myself to learn that much with opening down a GTX 710 because it's a very small card. But now we're looking at a legit big board. So there are three levels. The person that wants to try out overclocking, $100, they have a card that they can burn out if try overclocking on it. And then maybe the person that knows overclocking can try custom modifications, and maybe the person that's pretty good with overclocking can try to put it under liquid nitrogen and not waste that much money off of it. It's $100.
And actually, those cards will probably use a little bit less LN2 than the very big cards. So even if you go LN2 for first time on VGA, it's a good candidate because it's not going to cost you as much as going on a Titan or
It's a very small die. It's tiny. So
That's gonna be
really that's gonna be fun. Actually, there's a way the very very low end market is actually almost disappearing. Pretty much by itself, because the IGP, the integrated graphic processing unit from the CPU, is actually getting higher and higher. So very very low end is actually disappearing in a way. And then we have this thing, the IGP is not good enough for anything, and then you can have extra GPU to do extra stuff to it.
Yeah.
And it's it's good enough to be interesting, but it's cheap enough to play with it. And I think that's a sweet spot for pretty much anyone that wants to try out.
Sure.
You remember when they launched the Titan X and then 1080, etc. People were almost not even expecting a 1050 anyway. Everyone was Nvidia is done with those low-end cards. They're not going to do it again. All the low-end is going to be sort of reserved to AMD, and they will do that with the 460s and the other cards. But in the end, it seems like Nvidia has probably not changed their mind. It was probably always the plan, but just not the communication they wanted to have at that time. But
they wanted people to think they won't make one so they can buy the bigger one.
Yeah. I mean, in every generation, they always did that. They always come out with the two middle, so the 70 and the 80, and then the Titan, since we have the Titan, and then the low end. But I mean, it always changes. We can never know what they're going to planning, but I think it's the best bet for Nvidia to still keep the high end and put a bit of effort on the low end as well. It's worth it, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Well, at least it's good for us. It's good for us.
Yeah,
good
sure. For our wallet as well.
Yeah, Christmas is coming. Maybe that was also the plan.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's smash all the market.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Yeah. Finishing, you're gonna have the last word for this topic.
Well, maybe even on Black Friday the card can go lower again, so why not?
Let's buy 40 of them. Yeah.
4 XSLI.
Yeah. All right, let's move on to the last topic for tonight. Stories from TwitchCon. Yes, TwitchCon is mostly around games, but actually it's mostly around streaming, and that's exactly what we're doing here, and that's exactly what we're trying to push at Overclocking TV. So yeah, the TwitchCon, that's the annual Twitch convention that was held in San Diego. I think that was 3 weeks ago. And so I went there to explore the world of Twitch streamers, their relation to the hardware world. Actually, I was interested to see even console streamers and even regular PC streamers, creative streamers, they need to know a little bit about the hardware, right? They need to know a little bit what they need to have for hardware to stream. They need to know a little bit how to do it and configure that on the system. And actually, I found out that most of them are not quite versed actually in building their own PC and not quite versed in finding the right component for it, etc. So that was quite interesting to see that us overclockers or us hardware PC hardware enthusiasts, we have a lot of things to help out these people that want to build new PC for streaming, not only gamings. And that's quite interesting to see that even the big PC gamers, some of the times they have an extra PC to do the stream. So that's that was quite fun to see. I don't know if you can roll the video, Tim. I can talk about talk over it.
Stuff. Keep going.
So the convention, you could actually meet famous streamers, but there was a lot of panels from. Like I say, how to build your streaming PC, something I went to. Of course, I know how to build one, but I wanted to see, what is the kind of reaction to this guy? And actually, the how to build your streaming PC was full on five girls on the panel, not a single guy. And that was actually even better, because that's the first time as your proper panel give a big round of applause that was made by five women. So that was great. And actually, the girls there, there was the Leslie from AMD, there was Oh My God, Little Kitten, Femstaff, and I think Pancake Poe. And basically they were some of them did build PCs, some of them are consulting for it, and some of them are console gamers that need a PC for the streaming. So yeah, that was quite a nice convention, met a lot of new faces. We discover a little bit more about the creative side of Twitch that is actually exploding in a way. There's so many things going on the creative side. Actually, all the overclocking streams are actually streamed on the creative side of Twitch. So that's why I was quite interested to see what people can do. There's people like building PC, but there's people like painting, and there's like people like cooking.
Yeah. I think we deserve our own section, overclocking and PC hardware.
Yes. With for the games, instead you have all the benchmarks, so you can classify your streams. And
I mean, that at would some be point, awesome. You have to. In any gaming or tech industry, games run on a computer. So at some point they have to put one, because they're kind of gaming and PCs are together at some point.
Yeah. Even for more than cooking and computers, actually. For that
exactly.
But there's a need for a lot more people building their computers to actually stream it, even if you just test out. That's what actually BuildZoid is doing. That's what we are doing at OCTV. That's what I'm doing on my private channel as well. That's what you could be doing as well, Carl. So, of course, there's a potential for that, and there's a lot of people that are looking for... options and questions and so on. And of course, you can do that on the forum, you can do that on Facebook, and you can do that live as well. So don't forget, guys, if you want to stream what you're building your PC, let us know on OCTV. We might be able to re-host you from time to time. Besides all the panels, one thing that struck me the most at this convention is the vibe. I would say the vibe. The vibe was awesome. So much enthusiasm, positive attitudes. Everyone was sharing and helping in between the streamers, streamers and viewers. And there was no hate. There was people that didn't like each other, but that's in any community. But there was no hate. Everyone was like, oh my God, that's awesome. Oh, we can do that many things. There's people with a lot of ideas and ton of ideas taking the time to do it. I was like, wow, that's... I was actually surprised that it was such a positive community. And actually, I would love to see that to be in the OC world as well, get more positivity out from the overclocking world per se. We enjoy playing with hardware. We don't fight with hardware. We don't fight with each other. We play with hardware and we compete in competitions. Fine, that's one word. But before actually accessing the competition, that's maybe six competition. In live, and that's maybe 30 or 40 of them online. But everything else, we spend time on the computer. We spend time, tweaking, testing, sharing the tweaks, etc., etc. So yeah, have fun. That's the goal. Have fun. Learn what you can do with what you have, and that's that's what I really, take back from this convention. There was a lot of panels, awesome. Panels about esports, the challenge of creating an esports ecosystem. That's something that I did quite relate to it, because we have the OC esport now on the OC overclocking world. The change that were made toward making overclocking more esport friendly system. That's definitely going in the right direction. I can say that not as a community representative for HWBOT, but as an external guy watching this and knowing how esports actually being made, this is going in the right direction. It's not final yet for sure, but the way that we can have communities and etc. There's still a lot to do, and actually this will come from the community itself, the communities of Team, B people, followers, people gathering around to for a bench party. But the most important thing is create content out of that. Take pictures, share the picture online, not just on your own forum, just show the world what you can do and that this is fun to do. And please, please get more women in that space.
Yeah, that's
really, really, it's like today, like overclocking world is mostly a guy thing, and there's no reason for that except you play with computers. But games used to be a guy thing, and it's not a guy thing anymore because everyone was, you know, incorporated in that and have the same goal in there. Stop whining. Just creating content is the key for that. I want to actually just give a sideline. The after party was awesome.
I know you went just for that.
Actually, the people that know me know I like to party a lot.
It's okay, I go to TwitchCon. Yeah, I need this and that for budget, and I will shake hands and collect business cards, you know, and this awesome party, you know. But I'm not.
Let's say. Oh, come on. That was actually quite insane. They rent the complete park for it, like the Petco Park in San Diego, and that was like Darude. Darude playing, yeah, the whole thing, like completely the whole thing. I think that was like, I think like 80% of all the people at the convention were there. Honestly, mind blowing. Like this convention is the best I ever attended so far. Anyway, more panels. Actually, there was one panel that I loved a lot. Was the bandwidth requirement for streaming. And actually, I did discuss a little bit with Alaskan Savage and Insanity Live, that are quite two big streamers on Twitch. And one of the guys was living in Alaska, and he was having issue about streaming with the bandwidth and so on. And after the panel, we had a good discussion, and I explained to him, like, Dr. Wiz in South Africa is actually forced to stream over 4G because the landline is not good enough, and there's always like this, you know, latency issue that you have to, you know, take some, you know, proxies and servers and so on. And they were like, oh boy, that's even worse than us. Like, what? So yeah, that was you know, quite interesting to see this kind of panel and to see people, you know, going around and so on. Yeah, that was quite cool. And of course, there was some insane thing. I don't know if you guys catch that in the video, but that was like Shaquille O'Neal and Snoop Dogg playing games in front of, like, let's say, like a few thousand people, like sharing for them to know who will be fighting. So I was like, okay, this went to a point of non-return that, okay, gaming is it's the thing, right? We would never see that for overclocking, for sure. I don't think so, but we can work towards it. And that's going to be quite interesting. See, last thing, I want to give a big shout out to all the guys I met there, and they were actually like part of making this quite impressive. Femstaff, Pancake Poe, Oh My God Laser Kittens, Yeti in the Mist, and Bish Queen. Of course, there's much more than that, but that's the few one I wanted to point out. And maybe we're gonna have some of them on one of the podcasts in the next few weeks.
Cool.
That could be fun.
Oh,
nice. Yeah. All right, I think it's about 1 hour, so I think we made the turn. Most importantly, the Open Bench Table product is shipping to you guys, so get yours.
Actually, let's play the video.
Or take one from TwitchCon.
So Truth, you got yours this week, right?
Okay, we should just not do the dubbing every time we have to do that. You can unfold the feet and then screw them back. We have these new bolts done, but they're not the bolts. And they're the motherboard. The PSU powering that system with the awesome resistance and the crazy graphic card. You can get a thing for that. Of course, you have to cool it down. You can use the water cooling system or the liquid nitrogen cooling system. BC1 Open Bench Table. Get it now at openbenchtable.com. MSRP is $149.
You should reconvert in the advertising business. You're the wrong job.
Come on, I'm not a voice actor, but I love to do that kind of off credit things. All right.
Some conditions may apply.
Yeah, some customs may apply. All right, I think that's it for today. Thank you very much, Carl. Thank you very much, you guys, the viewers, for tuning in. And if you're watching this on YouTube, don't forget to go check out Carl's channel. Yes. What's the actually short name for your channel, Carl?
Mr. TechQC, youtube.com/user mrtechqc.
Awesome. So go check him out. And of course, don't forget to follow us on Twitch. If you're watching this on YouTube, go on Twitch and follow us, because we're going to be streaming more and more in the next few weeks. And we'll be doing the live open boxing, like unboxing of the BC1. That could be fun. Thank you, Timothy, for managing to get the sound back and doing all the things quite early in the morning for you in Taipei. This is the end of the live episode of the OC Show, and don't forget, until next time,
keep pushing it.
Keep pushing it.